Hello, Poland. Thank you very much for coming to my talk. I'm Lucas. I'm going to talk about hacking robots. I did this research with Cesar Cerrudo. He couldn't come. And we started thinking about this a year ago, a little bit more than a year ago. And we started wondering what was the current situation of robots in the world right now. So basically, we realized that robots were interconnected. They were connected to backend systems. They were connected with other computers. They were connected to other robots. So we realized, okay, this is a technology that is growing. It's not mainstream yet. And it's an opportunity for us to get something new, something innovative, and try to see what are the risks of robots and why it's different from IoT, why the risks are different. So basically, what we realized also is that there was no previous attack in the wild. No, we didn't realize, we didn't see any hack on the news about robots, some people getting hurt because of a hack, even though what we realized is that there were many accidents that were caused by robots. Basically, many human deaths were caused, but mainly because of malfunctioning. So we start wondering, okay, what could happen if someone forces the robot to malfunction with a purpose, no? So basically, we decided, okay, let's analyze 13 different robots that currently exist. But it's not that we just analyze them, just read the documentation. We actually were able to get the firmware for all these robots, get the firmware, get the mobile applications, get the all the applications that interact in this ecosystem of these robots. So we chose different type of robots. No, we chose home robots, business robots, and industrial robots. As you can see there, we chose robots from SoftBank, from Robotis, UbiTech. Basically, the Pepper one, the one from SoftBank, is one of the most famous business robots in the world. They are deployed approximately 20,000 right now, and the trend is growing. They are investing a lot of money. SoftBank is a huge company that is even recently, some months ago, they bought Boston Dynamics. So they have a lot of infrastructure, and they are going to grow this. No? So we decided to actually test these robots. So as you can see, they are basically computers inside. Most of them run Linux. So when we were starting, we said, OK, the same attacks will be the same as any other embedded devices. No? So the strategy, the initial strategy was the same, the initial approach to testing these machines. On the other hand, we decided to test industrial collaborative robots. But these collaborative robots are the newer generation of the typical industrial. The ones we are used to are the ones that they are inside a cage in a factory. For example, they are manufacturing. They are, for example, the ones that build cars. No, they are typically isolated from people. People don't work too close to these robots because they don't have a sense of the environment. They move around because they were programmed to do that, but they don't have awareness of the environment. But this new generation of robots, the collaborative ones, they use cameras, they use sensors, they use different other things to capture the physical world and to understand it and to take reactions and to take decisions. No? So basically, we chose Universal Robots, a very big company, which has around 10,000 robots in the world deployed in many different industries, and also Rethink Robotics. So as you can see in these pictures from the app on the top of the slide, you can see people working with these collaborative robots, but they aren't using any kind of protection. They aren't using helmets. They aren't using anything. And this is because these robots, they have some safety features that prevent hurting humans. No, we will see later what could happen if someone disabled it. And we will show examples of this. But basically, the concept is that these robots, they can be used in any kind of industry. As you can see on the bottom, they are like a robotic kitchen. And then a DARPA did like a pilot, no? A robot to take off planes, to land planes. So once you have these robots, and they are so flexible, you can adapt them into any other kind of robot. So the trend is that all these multi-purpose robots, for example, arm robots and these, they will grow and they will be adapted into new robots. So also we wanted to research robot controllers. Robot controllers are basically the bridge between the physical world and the software. No, there are many companies, especially in Japan, that they have been designing robots for 40 years. No, like the kind you can see in amusement parks, for the animatronic robots. No, but they don't have a good software for that. It's all mostly mechanic, electric. No, so these companies, what they do is to create a software that makes a bridge between them. So we wanted to test also one of these softwares, and we chose Visaido, no? Because many robots use them. As you can see in the picture, those are some of them that they use this software. So if we can attack this software, we can attack the robot. So we are going to see a quick video about these robots in action. The important thing is that all these robots that you will see in the video are the ones that were included in our research, no? In our research to test the security of these robots. And we found many, many problems, most critical issues. So the main idea is to get a sense of what these robots can do and the reality. So let's see the video. So basically, what was the research approach? How we tested this robot without actually having them? So what we did was to try to find the most amount of documentation and available publicly software that we could find on the internet. We just downloaded all the firmware images, all the binaries, all the web applications, the mobile applications. As I said before, all the entire ecosystem that we could have access to, we just downloaded. And we did around for 2 months, we did a security assessment over them. It wasn't very deep because we tried to get variety in the stuff that we were finding. We tried to get variety in order to get examples of which are the possible threats and to show proof how it is possible to actually exploit them and what could happen in the post-exploitation. So we found, over these six companies, we found many, many critical issues. We reported around 50 security vulnerabilities, and I'm very sad to say that not many of them were patched yet. We will see that later. So basically, we realized first that for an attacker, in order to discover a robot in the network, there is a protocol which is widely used among robots called multicast DNS, basically to advertise the robot presence in the network. So when the robot connects to the network, they just advertise themselves using DNS. So it is very easy for someone who is on the same network to find the robot. They don't need to do service fingerprinting. They don't need to do this kind of techniques. So basically, we found that these kind of robots, like, for example, business robots, they are typically connected to airport networks, to hospital networks. They are typically using a shared network with the clients, with the customers, with the people. They don't have dedicated networks because it's very expensive right now to just create expensive networks just for the robot itself. So basically, they say, okay, we need the robot to move around the entire facility. Let's connect it to the corporate network or the guest network, no? So this is one way that people can find the robot in the network by using multicast DNS, no? They use that and they say, okay, this service is a robot. So we found, as usual, many authentication, authorization vulnerabilities. This is very common with other technologies that we analyze every day. Basically, many control ports of the robot are open, and through these ports, you can manipulate the joints of the robot. We found this on many, many different robots, that it was possible to get, for example, video feed, to get audio feed of the microphone, everything without authentication. There were some robots, for example, Pepper, the white one, the most famous, one of the most famous robots in the world, right now, they had authentication, but it was possible to bypass it, no? For example, they have a web application to administer the robot, and basically, they were using Nginx web server, and they were using a regular expression to filter which files will have the authentication module. And as you can see there, they were only using this QI messaging .js, a JavaScript file, which is a static file. So they were preventing authentication to that file only. So basically, if you can download the firmware of the robot and you can pull this file from the robot, and then you don't need to request it to the robot again for authenticating. You just have it. It's something local. So basically, there is no real authentication in this robot, no? For example, when someone tries to enter to the resources of the web console of the robot, all the resources are not protected except from this JavaScript file, but the browser shows that actually it requires a password, but it's not true. It just requires a password for that file. So as you can see, they implemented wrong the authentication on this robot. And we were wondering, okay, why they put this kind of authentication? And we realized that Pepper, this robot, basically, it's a business robot. It's a robot meant to be out for consumers. But before this company, they bought a research robot from another company. And this research robot didn't have any kind of authentication in any port, in nothing, because it's a research robot. And typically, research projects, they don't have too much security. So we were wondering, OK, maybe there are some other problems into this robot, no, that are inherited because of a research robot. And that's another root cause for problems. We will explore later what happened with Pepper and research robot. What's the problem of research robots? So another example that we wanted to explore is human damage. No, since we analyzed all the firmwares and we were able to find all this software in the internet,
It was very hard for us from Argentina to just buy these robots. We had to just check, okay, which are the most the most cheap to buy, which was one $2,000 and the other one $5,000, I think. But the only reason that we bought them was just to do demonstrations, just to show the people, just to create awareness. No, so for one of these robots, the home robot, a very small robot from China. What we did basically is we discovered one open port on the robot, and we started analyzing how this port processes all the orders. So basically, we just send actions to the robot, and we discovered that we could manipulate the joints. So this all, in theory, sounds very easy to understand, but maybe someone who is not technical doesn't understand what's going on, doesn't understand the consequences. We will see a video of one of these robots. And the main interesting part of this is that the company that created this robot, they did a promotional video on how possible is for the robot to have a screwdriver in the hand. No, so if we combine these two elements, no, hacking with screwdriver is not going to end up very well. So we will see a video that this company did, and then afterwards a video that we recorded in our home, just to prove a point.
Hand to handyman.
All right, I got the flange off. What's next, Alpha?
Step 4, use a small screwdriver to attach the adapter flange.
Thanks, Alpha.
Chucky, Chucky.py.
Hi, I'm Chucky, and I'm your friend to the end. Hidey-ho.
So the main idea is to see that the robot is small, is inoffensive, but the trend is that these kind of robots, they will start getting more stable in the way that they stand. They will start getting more strength, more power. No, so it's something that we should take into consideration, the physical damage that this robot can create. Another side of the story that we wanted to explore are the robots as insider threats, because what could happen if the robot gets hacked, no, inside the company, inside a sensitive environment where a lot of information or secrets are being said, no? So we realize that many robots have HD cameras, they have directional microphones, even, for example, they can leak trade secrets because even the, for example, the industrial robots, they have cameras on the tool itself, so they are very close to the production. No, so if someone can hack this, they can observe a lot of information that could be valuable for different type of attackers. Also, we realize that these robots, they have also face recognition abilities. So this only makes for the attacker that is able to compromise the robot, it makes easier, because if the attacker enters the robot and he just is able to see a database with all the different persons that the robot recognize, it's much easier, no, to get information about one specific person. And on the other hand, many robots that we saw, they are, for example, this one from Hitachi. We didn't analyze this one, but we know that this robot, they can move around an entire office. They can create a plan, no? So people get used to seeing the robot around. It's something. It's like a dog. It's like an animal who is moving around, and maybe you can ask questions, but. The possibility of an insider threat is real, because if someone plants a backdoor there, or someone plants some kind of specific malware that gets information and leaks information like audio, or for example text-to-speech or speech-to-text abilities, no? And he just send a report of everything that he heard during the day, for example. So it could be something real. We tried to do an example of this, no? In one of the robots, this robot Pepper, he has a younger brother called Nao, which is a smaller robot. It's more for research purposes, but basically the code that is behind is exactly the same. Almost 95%
it is shared, no, with this research robot from another company. SoftBank grabbed this research robot and they put a new body to it and they changed some components and they started selling it to the public. So we realized that in one of these services that was exposed, it was one model called the proxy, and we were able to access through this proxy to all different models, like audio, video, movements, no? For this, you need to know the specification of this protocol. But the specification was exactly the same as the research robot. So by reading the SDK of the research robot, we were able to understand how to get the video feed, for example, no? We script some Python, and then we were able to get the video, and the motion. So we were able to actually control, for example, the head in order to look for something specific and then capture the video. For example, an example of this, you can see here I start the spy tool, no, over one of these robots. This is my home in Buenos Aires. So basically we are able to connect to the robot through this open port, understand the protocol, and then just with the arrow keys of the keyboard, just move the head in order to capture other video. No, so it is very easy, and there is no authentication in this. There is no authentication because it's a research robot, and typically they want to add flexibility, so they say, no, you don't need authentication for doing this. The problem is that Pepper, the next generation robot of this, the evolution, is for commercial purposes, but they even didn't put any kind of authentication on this. So also we wanted to check what could happen with the information that the robot gets, no? In this case, we found that one of these robots, this Chinese robot from Ubitech, he was sending GPS coordinates encrypted, no, to some servers in China. They were sending all the photos that the robot was taking. They were automatically synced to the cloud. This robot typically have like a cloud service where all the information that the robot has is being uploaded to the network, no? They were sending email, telephony data, and also he was capturing all the voice data that, for example, I was talking in my room and the robot was capturing everything and was sending it to a local network IP address. We didn't understand that. We think it was just a debugging mistake. But maybe if this information it was saved, we don't know if maybe once a month all this information is being sent. No, we didn't reverse engineer the entire robot. We just reverse engineered some parts of the robot. So, and we realized that the robot can be controlled from the cloud. So someone who is on the cloud can control the robot itself. And also we realized that they were transmitting everything in clear text. So no HTTPS. Only HTTP, which was very intriguing, no? Basically, because when we started researching about this robot, we came across with an Indiegogo campaign by them. This is the way that they were trying to get funding. No, they were trying to get funding, and one of the items about privacy that captured our attention to analyze this robot was this. They were saying, we truly believe that customer privacy is sacred. We work hard to protect your information from unauthorized access and have designed policies and control to safeguard the collection, use, and disclosure of your information. All this in plain text, no? They were sending all the information in plain text, so evidently they don't care too much about privacy. And also we saw that they were saying, how secure is this? Alpha 2 uses MySQL encryption to secure personal data sent to and from the cloud. So we don't understand how they use MySQL encryption for transport encryption. Maybe it's a new kind of protocol they are working on and we don't know about, but we think this is crazy. So we realized that these kind of techniques, no, marketing techniques that companies sometimes use, like putting some difficult words into the way they promote the robots, in order for people to say, okay, it's secure. If they use MySQL encryption, probably is something secure. Let's buy this robot. And this robot was $2,000. It's not super cheap, no, to buy. On the other hand, what we did was to get what would happen if the same robot has two different computers, two different elements, no, that intercommunicate. For example, for Pepper, he has a tablet in the chest, and also he has like a computer in the head, no. So we were wondering what would happen with this communication. Is the communication do they have something that they trust? For example, the head trusts the tablet, and the tablet trusts the head, and they have some kind of isolation there, or anyone can obtain information that is meant to be only for the tablet or only for the head. No? So by reverse engineering the main core binaries of this robot, we realized that there were some functions that were meant to be only used for this communication, but they were open. So for example, anyone could retrieve the authentication token in order to authenticate to the cloud. I try to go fast on this, basically because all the technical details we released on a paper. There is a technical paper online called the same as this talk. So if you are more interested about all the technical details and that, you can find a paper, only technical, and we also did another paper which is non-technical, so anyone can understand this. All the problems in very high level. No, that's why I will skip some very technical stuff in order for you to, after, if you are interested, you go there and you get information. But maybe you find it boring to just talk about technical things. So what we wanted to research, basically, one of the key elements was the possibility of robots attacking humans, no, of robots hurting humans. And we realized that right now, robots that can actually cause harm to humans are the industrial ones, basically because they have strength. They have force, they can move fast. Right now, the other robots, they don't have too much strength. Maybe they can hit you, but it's not going to hurt too much. So we try to research, okay, what is preventing now for robots, industrial collaborative robots, to hurt someone. And we realized that they implement different safety protections. For example, self-collision sensors and external collision sensors. These sensors, what they do basically is to protect hitting someone. No? As you can see in the picture, there are many Chinese people working in an array of many robots. In this plant in China, there are 60 robots. So basically, they work very close without helmet, without nothing. So we were wondering how they do that. It's magic, no? So we realized that typically what they have is different protections that allow the robot to not cross certain places. And why is that? Because there were many research, no, publicly available from universities, that they guarantee that this robot, they can cause a skull fracture. So if they move very fast, in their maximum speed or the minimum sometimes, they can even break a bone, no? So that's why they put a lot of effort into creating these safety protections. And basically, there are companies that they are the ones that install this robot into, for example, into the manufacturing company. And these companies, they decide all the safety settings. They do calculations and this, and they are called integrators. The integrators, they are typically the ones that they limit force, momentum, they limit everything in order to make the workers safe. No, they, for example, also what they put some IO sensors, no, some infrared sensors in order, for example, when a person gets close to the robot starts changing the behavior, and for example, the maximum speed gets limited. So the robots, it's almost impossible to hurt someone if this works correctly. On the other hand, there are some safety planes that you can configure for the robot in order to make the robot restricted into a three-dimensional space and never cross some part, no? Because maybe there is a worker there. So the robot will never take the decision to go over that route. These are basically the most common the most common ways of avoiding hurting people in industrial, and also we saw this in some business robots. So what we did was an exploit that it chained 6 different vulnerabilities. I did a blog post about this called Exploiting Industrial Collaborative Robots on the IOActive blog. We explain it all in detail, but I'm going to try to just explain the most important elements. So basically what we did for this exploit, the main idea was to disable all these the safety protections. Because if we can control the joints and move it around, it's not there is no risk, because we know that nobody will be around in in certain plane, no? But if we can disable these safety planes, we can go beyond that. So probably we will hit someone. So we wanted to make a real world exploit. So we chained, for example, the first step was to get the remote version. We got a version disclosure in one of the services. We got path disclosure also about where the main binary was being loaded. This is in order to make more reliable the exploit, no? And what we did also was to exploit a stack base buffer overflow vulnerability in one of the Modbus TCP services that was open. We were reading and writing registers into the robot through this service, no, to this Modbus service. And we realized that the receive function that gets all this information from the Modbus service, we realized that there was a buffer overflow problem there. So all the information that we were sending into the robot, it was processed in a way that we could control the length and also the type of information that we will be overwriting into the robot memory. No, so I'm not gonna go very in detail about this exploit, but basically, what our first goal was to get a reverse shell to this robot. And always, for me personally, when I want to achieve this reverse shell, I start from the end to the what I need to achieve, and then I go back. No, so first, what I needed to achieve is to call the interruption instruction int 0x80. Then I needed to set up some registers, so I needed to set up different registers in order to prepare them. So when I call this instruction in the processor of the robot, I will get the reverse shell. So in order to make this preparation, I had to prepare many things. I had to prepare many strings on memory in the robot. And for doing this, since the robot was running with ASLR, no, the robot was the binary was compiled with NX, so it was not possible to execute code from the stack. So we had to use ROP, return oriented programming. So we did a lot of gadgets for this. So basically, as you can see there on the bottom, the main goal was to call the exec VE system call that connects to our IP address. No, this is the main goal, and for doing this, we had to arrange the stack, we had to arrange the bytes that we're going to send to the robot, and we had to divide in different stages. We had to make a stage one, then jump to stage two, and then finally call the interaction instruction, and then get the reverse shell. No, and for doing this, they were many gadgets. I think it was 90 gadgets each stage. No, and basically what they do is to set up in memory some strings about, for example, my IP address, different stuff on memory, and then on runtime, I will zero out different values. For example, I couldn't send zeros over the network to the robot, but if I send something else, and then on runtime, I replace this content for zeros, so I can do much more. So basically, the two stages are basically to organize the memory into the robot before triggering the interruption gadget. As you can see in the stage two at the end, there is an int 0x80 gadget that once we call that, everything is ready on the memory. You can have a more detailed explanation on this on the blog post, but basically the concept is that we get a reverse shell of the robot running as root, no? So we have a root shell in the robot. So now we have a remote root to the robot. What we were able to do is to modify safety configuration files. These safety configuration files, they aren't meant to be changed even by the owners of the robot. Only the integrators are the ones that they can change these settings, all the boundaries, all the force limits, and that. No, but this is just a file. This is just a file on the file system. So we could modify all these values. We could modify the force. We could disable everything. The only problem, no, was that basically they were calculating a checksum over most of these values, over, for example, force, speed, and velocity, they were making a checksum, and then storing it into the same file. But this is not real integrity. We already know that a checksum is not meant for real integrity, for a security level integrity. No? So basically, it was very easy to force a collision into the checksum because it's just 2 bytes. We were able to add, for example, force 50, no? And we try force 50, comma 0001, and just it's a different checksum. So we will try that until we brute force that in order to get the same checksum as the one that was before. So it is no real integrity. There is no integrity over these kind of files. So afterwards, reset the robot in order to make it work again with the new settings. This is because process continuation is very relevant in exploitation because we don't want the robot to be stopped for 1 minute because the Chinese people in the factory will start wondering, okay, what happened here, no? So the main idea is to get a process continuation. I use a technique here. You can check more information in the blog post. So basically, once we restarted the robot, we loaded the new safety setting files. We loaded the new configuration without any limit, without a limit of plane, space, or force. And we, through one of these services into the robot, we can manipulate the joints. We can move the robot around. This is without authentication. This is another problem that we found. But basically, if we combine these two, if we combine the exploit that we did with this, which is just a script, just a Python script sending the move J command in order to move the robot, we can actually have a very powerful weapon, even without using guns or explosives, no? Because this is something that it is actually can move very fast. So we are going to see a demo. We used to do this live, but it was a lot of virtual machines. So because this company, they provided a virtual machine with an environment for the robot. So we are going to just see a demo now, which is because it's faster also. So basically, we found a lot of similarities with other robots. No? In other robots, we were able to disable the human safety settings. And this is because also they want to add flexibility. They want you to make be able to disable this in order to make the robot maybe get closer to someone, to touch someone, to touch a button, for example. And if the robot has a lot of anti-collision systems, the robot cannot work properly. No? So we found many ways of disabling in different robots. You can read more in the technical paper. But basically, another kind of problem that we found was research frameworks. Research frameworks are great for research purposes, but we discovered that many, many companies, they adopted research frameworks that in this case, for example, ROS is one of the most popular. It's a great project. It's a great project, but they don't have authentication, they don't have encryption, they don't have sender verification, they don't have many things. They are working on that, and on the next release, I think they will implement all this. The main problem is that there are so many different companies, so many different companies that adopted this research framework, and then they started selling to the public. No, they started selling a consumer product. So this is a huge mistake, because in the documentation of this research project, they say this is not for production. This is just to add flexibility, to start quickly a research project, but it's not for production. So we identify many different companies. Even, for example, the Dubai police, the robot from Dubai police is based on a robot that is using this, is using ROS, this framework. So we guess that there are many, many robots still using this. We discover many physical attacks to robots, mainly because robots, they aren't meant to be used inside the data center. They aren't meant to be used inside the cage. So basically, we discover that these robots are meant to be used with people. They are meant to, not maybe the industrial too much, but still the business robots and the other ones, they are surrounded by people 24/7 almost, in a shopping mall, in an airport, everywhere. So we realize that there are many ports, like USB ports, Ethernet ports, no, many ways of, for example, turning off the robot. There are many ways of installing new software on the robot, no? Also, I'm gonna skip this because we don't have much time, but also we wanted to explore the possibility what could happen if the company itself or a government pushes the company of robots to actually take control of all the robots that they have in the company. No? And we discovered that this Visido, this software, they are actually sending the pairing key that you use to control the robot to the server, to the main server. So what could happen in the future if all the governments, they have power to all these pairing keys, no? And they can control all the robots at the same time, for example. Or maybe someone hack this company, they have all the pairing keys, and that's it. They can move all them at once. So we also explored in the paper the possibility of having ransomware in robots. Basically, the robot itself, they don't store information, but they process information. But the most important thing is that robot right now is workforce. Robots are meant to work, most of them. They are meant to work. So we did an example. We did a blog post with some videos on that. If you are interested, just check ransomware for robots. In internet, and we did a remote attack over Pepper, and we installed a malicious software that actually blocks himself and doesn't do anything. It is impossible to restore the firmware, and you take real control of the robot. And people we realized different ways to coerce the owners to pay, no? Because it's very likely to pay, because it's very expensive to send the robot back to America or back to the manufacturing place. So sometimes it's more cheap to just pay, and that's it. So we analyze this in detail as well. So basically, to finish this presentation, the main problems that we found are the same, nearly the same, that we found in other technologies, IoT, embedded devices, medical devices. So, but the main difference is the impact, is how these robots will begin to interact with us in the future. And because it's not a mainstream technology yet. Right now we don't see robots around everywhere. But the trend is that this is growing, and all these problems that we already know how to fix them. So it's an opportunity for us to assist all these companies.
So basically, the consequences are pretty obvious. In home, privacy issues right now, because they aren't very strong. In business and industries, espionage also. Espionage could be also human damage, because they could hit like a customer, for example. But we really wanted to test military and healthcare, but we didn't have access to this kind of technologies. But we know that these are the ones that directly threat human more. So are the one of the most interesting for in a perspective of the consequences, no? So the responses from the vendors basically were very, very disappointing. For example, Universal Robot, they said, I think the findings are very interesting, something we should do about it, and a smiley face. The other companies, basically, they didn't acknowledge too much what we did. They never asked questions or ask for assistance or something else. No, nothing. They all say is thanks. And we follow up with them after a few months. They didn't fix anything. So we waited like 7 months until we publish all this information, this technical information. But we hope they fix it in the future. We don't know if now these findings are actually fixed yet, but we don't think so, because I checked 1 month ago and it wasn't fixed already. So none of these findings that you will see in the report were fixed almost. All the remote command execution, memory corruption issues that we could compromise the robot, none of them were fixed. So the strategy to improve world robot security is first create awareness. That's why we did these kind of videos, more for the media, more for the people that don't understand too much the technical part. I think it's very important to create awareness that this is possible. Yeah, this is possible with examples, not just a shell console with matrix stuff. So basically, also to improve the factory reset mechanisms, because it is very hard to factory reset a robot. If you know that the robot has been hacked, how do you fix it? See, right now it's impossible. We saw in the robots that it was not possible to factory reset properly. Also, secure by default, no? Many problems with secure by default, like in other technologies. Also something very important is education, no? Education of the people that work in these companies to know a little minimum about cybersecurity. Also, we realize that many people is investing a lot of money in marketing, a lot, and we discover why is that. And the reality is that robots is a technology that for the last 80 years, people has been dreaming of. People want robots. It's like, I want robots because it's like a link with the future. If I have a robot, I am part of the future. So people get like obsessed with robots, and they push these companies to see cool stuff. They want to see how cool the robots are. So these companies, they have to impress the consumers. And they create very crazy videos. They create flashy videos in order to make the people get crazy. It's like Boston Dynamics, every time they release a video, everyone gets crazy, no? And this is basically the power of marketing. Many of these robots, they don't even do what they are promoted in the marketing material. This robot we use with a screwdriver, it's impossible that the robot will come with a screwdriver. He cannot even go down to pick it up, no? So it's all like a strategy, no? To convince people that the robots are ready, no? And what we saw is that still is it's not mature technology, at least for the home robots, but the other one, the trend is that it's going further. The trend is there, they have been much better than some years ago. So we expect that in the future, in the nearer future, we will have much more robots around. So basically, robots are awesome, but they are insecure. Many human safety protections don't work, basically because there is no isolation between the components that check that we are healthy, that they are not going to hurt us. They are in the same place that the other components that care about network stuff, no? So the key is to make isolation between these two components. And until this doesn't happen, we won't see too much robots providing enough safety, no? So for now, marketing is winning, but we still have time because this is not mainstream technology yet. We still have time for doing this. I invite you to read the paper, the non-technical paper, if you are not a very technical person, or the other one, if you want to know more about the attacks. Thank you very much for coming and staying. Thank you.